Well, you can't go wrong starting your church service with cartoons, because that makes us happy. It's fitting for today's message. Gives us a humorous look at our culture. I don't know if it's that there's a lot of realistic attributes to that cartoon, or if maybe our culture is rather cartoonish. But the way that we go about trying to find happiness is a bit comical. Jesus would say that. We're talking about happiness this morning, and the reason is because we read about it 9 times in the first 12 verses of Matthew chapter 5. It's a little bit hidden because it's disguised by the word blessed. But the word blessed, as I spoke last week, is used of a person who deserves to be congratulated. That's a blessed person, one who lives a life that everyone else wishes they had. A blessed life. It's translated in other places as happy. Happy or content. That's why their life is so enviable. Because everybody wants to be happy. I hear people say that all the time. I do. I'm guessing you do too. We want to be happy. French inventor and mathematician Blaise Pascal in the 1600s said, "All men seek happiness. This is without exception," he says. "Whatever different means they employ, they all tend to this end. Everybody wants to be happy." British philosopher John Locke, who died in 1704, he agrees with this. He at one time during his life wrote about man's relentless pursuit of happiness in a book called An Essay of Human Understanding. In 1776, Thomas Jefferson borrowed that phrase, life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. We all thought that he was the one who coined the term. No, John Locke was, but Thomas Jefferson took that phrase and incorporated it into America's DNA, or I'm sorry, Declaration of Independence. And so, pursuing happiness not only continues to be a basic human urge that we all share, but thanks to Thomas Jefferson, it has now become, over the course of our own history, a patriotic duty. You owe it to yourself and your country to be happy, because that's what this country is founded on. 250 years later, after the writing of the Declaration of Independence, some 250 years, it's become a full-blown commercial enterprise. You ever notice that? I mean, again, the video sort of reflects that idea that we make good money off of peddling the idea that we can be happy if we buy the right product. Americans spend billions of dollars each year on goods and services, all promising to help them attain happiness. But the truth is this morning, and I hope you believe me when I say that without God, we are on a hamster wheel. We are chasing something that will never be attained if we're pursuing happiness apart from God's direction. So thank you, Jesus. He comes and teaches us how to be happy. But back to American culture for one moment before we dig into Scripture. We've been pursuing happiness for a quarter of a millennia in this country and still haven't attained it. We're like the hamster on the wheel. It's been 250 years. Still can't find happiness, and so what we've done instead is we have turned our attention to combating sadness. I don't know if you recognize the difference. Instead of chasing happiness, which we can't find, we are now waging war on sadness. $28.6 billion are spent every year in this world on antidepressants. They are now used by 1 in 8 Americans, if you didn't know. This is in a study published last month. So current statistics tell us that 1 out of every 8 Americans use them. all that to say that we are against sadness. We are antidepressant in this country because we're pro-happy. But 250 years has proven that happiness is very elusive, and so then we turn our attention to not being sad, haven't we? We think that sadness is some alien thing that we should never feel. We think that no one should ever be depressed, and so if you are, something's wrong. We need to fix that. And Jesus comes along and says, you're happy if you mourn. You're happy if you're sad. You're happy if you're spiritually impoverished. You're happy if you're spiritually hungry. You're happy if you actually have all of those things we're trying to avoid with pills and alcohol and entertainment and amusement parks and plastic surgery and all the other things that are meant to make our lives happy that we chase like rats. I'll tell you that even human beings want to be happy. Blaise Pascal nailed that one. All Americans want to be happy. Thomas Jefferson nailed that one. But I'll tell you that even God wants us to be happy. So it's not evil to desire happiness or even to pursue it because God wants us to be happy. If that wasn't true, he wouldn't have sent Jesus to share with us the first 12 verses of chapter 5 on how to be happy and what happiness actually looks like. What mixes us up in our culture, at least, is when we pursue happiness in unholy ways. That's our problem. We aren't pursuing happiness the way Jesus instructed. We're pursuing happiness the way our culture teaches. And it's messing us up. People make the mistake of pursuing happiness physically and mentally with little regard to what it's doing to them spiritually, and that's where the great damage is being done. The happiness that Jesus describes for us in these first 12 verses is not contingent on circumstantial variables. We really think that it is. That's why the divorce culture is so popular. If you don't make me happy, I take the ring back and I go find somebody who will. And if they don't make me happy, I take that ring back and I repeat the process. If this job doesn't make me happy, I quit this one and I go and find something else. If that one doesn't make me happy, I quit that one and go find a different one. And if I keep on that pattern for too long, I realize that I just need a different education. I go back to school. Some people believe that additional classes is the key to happiness, and so they're students into perpetuity. You know what I'm talking about? The ones that never graduate? All kinds of leads that we follow, thinking that it will make us happy. But again, it's not contingent on externals. Bigger house, faster car, younger spouse, better job, stronger body, newer phone. That's actually not the key to happiness. Jesus is explaining something entirely foreign to that concept, or entirely alien to American thinking. So, first 12 verses of chapter 5 is just for us this morning. I'm not saying it's not meant for the rest of the world. I'm saying it's perfect for you and I because of the culture that we live in that says that happiness can be found anywhere but God. Am I right? We do live in a culture that thinks that, and a lot of even Christians assume that if they actually look to God for answers in life, and if they actually follow Christ, that God's going to take away their happiness. There's a lot of people with this misperception of what it means to follow Christ. They think that if I follow Jesus and I start obeying God, he's going to take away all the fun stuff. You know, sex and drugs and alcohol. That's just a great misunderstanding of where happiness is found. That's all that is. Okay? And by the way, he doesn't take away sex. For those of you who are just really that's your issue, he doesn't take it away. He teaches you how it's supposed to be done. And go ahead and pursue happiness all you want in that area. It won't be blessed by God. You'll never know what it's like to be blessed by God. Career in and of itself is an evil. But when you're thinking you're going to be happy through a job, that you're going to be made happy through a job, no wonder you're so miserable. You had it wrong. And Jesus comes and goes, here's how you find happiness in life. And so we need to give him our attention. When Jesus uses the term blessed 9 times in a row in 12 verses, He's actually referencing a condition of the soul. Okay, that's what he's referring to here. It's the condition of a person's soul. The problem is that most people, when they sense that discontent in their soul, that unhappiness in their soul, they try to remedy that unhappiness by treating the flesh. Okay? By pampering the flesh. By medicating the flesh. Okay? By treating the flesh, not the soul. And so we think that the answer is found in fixing the flesh, the body, the mind. We binge in hopes of being happy. We splurge. We indulge on all kinds of things, everything from junk food to drugs, sexual immorality, mindless entertainment. And it's deceiving. It's deceiving because it does make you happy. But the happiness it provides through sexual immorality, drugs, all that, is brief. It's temporary, and it leaves you with an ever-worsening sadness of soul that is being neglected while you pursue superficial happiness, or what I would call superficial glee. It may improve the mood for a while, but it neglects the soul, and so the condition worsens. The deepest happiness that's available to you and I, the kind that's described by Jesus in chapter 5, cannot happen apart from holiness. That's the key to happiness. You will only find it through holiness, through Christ-likeness, by believing what he says and acting upon the things he teaches. All men and women seek happiness. That's what Blaise Pascal said in the 1600s. I already told you that. All of us seek happiness, but very few of us, if I may say, will ever seek holiness. That's the problem. Everybody wants to be happy. Very, very few people are interested in being holy. And that's the problem. John Phillips once wrote, "Happiness and holiness always go hand in hand. And the reason we see so little genuine happiness among men is because there's so little holiness." And that's why Jesus says that those who have actually found it should be congratulated and envied. They're living the life that everybody else wishes they had but can't find and don't know how to live because we're ignoring Jesus' instructions on how to actually be happy because they're counterintuitive to what we believe and what the world has taught, what the world's mantra is. The world says, these things will make you happy, these things will make you happy. And then Jesus, 2,000 years before, had actually come along and said, actually, flip that upside down. This is what will make you happy. We covered the first two last week, but we read them, and I'll read them again. In verse 3, he says, blessed or happy are the poor in spirit. They should be congratulated. Their life is to be envied, because theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Theirs is the kingdom of heaven. In verse 4, he says, blessed are those who mourn. Happy are those who are sad. Isn't that wild? I told you, Jesus is presenting us with an upside-down kingdom. But he says, these are his words, original Greek. Happy are the sad. Blessed are those who mourn. Why? Because they will be comforted. Will be. Future tense. One day. Right now in this life, Christians mourn. Why? Because it's hard. Because this world is so anti-Christ. And even in the church, if you stand up for Christian principles and you want a life of holiness, you're probably going to be ridiculed by half the even Christians that are out there. No, oh, you're so conservative. You're so uptight. We're so liberal. You should be like us. No, Jesus said you should be sexually pure. He said to put away lust. So I got to do that. It's terrible. I'm tired of living the Christian life. Whoa, did the pastor just say he's tired of living the Christian? Yeah. It's wearying. I'm worn out, right? And Jesus goes, you're blessed. That's a good spot to be. One, it says that you're at war. You're in the battle. You haven't given up yet. You're tired, yeah, but you haven't quit. That's good. Keep going. And the day of your comfort, relief, the truest rest I've promised, will come one day. Just not now. So keep going. In verse 5, he says, blessed are the meek. Meekness is so unpopular here. Nobody wants to be meek like Jesus. It's humble. Meekness is power under control. It's when you could execute revenge, but you won't let yourself. You will wait patiently on God who said, vengeance is mine. And so this is those who, when they're slighted, like when they're slapped on one cheek, they turn the other one and offer that to be slapped by their enemy as well. Meekness means I could retaliate, but I won't. And not only will I refrain from retaliation, I'm also going to take action and love you in return. So it's not just a neutral thing. This godly character will love their enemies and pray for those who persecute them, as we'll see. But meekness is power under control. I can't remember who said it, but I quoted here. So some anonymous author this morning said, there's a wonderful cooperation between a powerful horse and its rider. An animal of tremendous size and strength, 7 or 8 times the weight of the man, submits itself to its master's control. A horse may race, leap, turn, prance, or stand motionless at the rider's slightest command. That's strength under perfect control, and that defines the Christian concept of meekness. Okay? I have, and so do you, what we call a will. We call it a free will. I don't know if they call that in other countries, but we Americans call it free will, meaning I get to do whatever I want. And when it comes to God, that's true. He will let you do whatever you want. Did you know that? Like if you want to leave the sanctuary this afternoon, because I get done preaching at like 3 or 4. So if you, the visitors are sweating now, but no. If you want to leave the sanctuary doors as soon as we're finished here and go out and do the most atrocious, commit the most atrocious acts of sin against God, he'll let you. If you want to go out and you want to commit the a little, not too bad, but kind of like, I know I shouldn't do it, but I'm going to anyway, he'll let you. If you want to obey him and you want to surrender yourself to him, he'll let you. He'll let you. It's all decided by the horse. Okay? The horse at any moment still of its own free will, and it certainly has the strength to do so, could buck his rider and trample him at any given moment. Did you know that? Any horse is capable of that. But well-trained horses, broken horses, those who are, if I may borrow the term, those horses that are poor in spirit, won't do that to their rider. They're meek. And Jesus goes, you're the happy ones. Because I have for thousands of years been watching those who buck their rider. And those people are not happy. Jesus says, Christian or not, I see all kinds of people bucking God all the time. And they are the most miserable. And you know why? One, because it just doesn't work with the universal system that God has established. Two, God won't let you be happy. He will deliberately, if you buck him like that, he will deliberately withhold all happiness and joy from you so that all you got is that thrill of the flesh that misleads you into thinking that you're happy when you're not and further injures your soul. That's where that goes, guys. So he says, blessed are the meek. Why? They shall inherit the earth. That's phenomenal. That's phenomenal that Jesus goes, anybody who's willing to submit themselves to what God says in this life, he knows it's so difficult that it deserves a reward. And he goes, I'm going to give you the, here, how's this for a reward? Planet Earth. Planet Earth. Jesus in another place goes, what would it profit for a man to gain the whole world and lose his soul? And then here he goes, the world is up for grabs. Okay? But you don't get it here. I promise you one day, for the meek, you will. You will. And so Jesus says, blessed are the meek. That term describes people who are ready to be thought nothing of. People who are fully prepared to be thought nothing of in this life, just like Jesus was. Do you know that Jesus was ready? He came here into this planet to be thought nothing of. And generally speaking, people thought nothing of him. Yet he was a king. He was God Almighty, clothed in flesh. Okay, he came as a man, and yet he was meek. He describes himself as gentle and lowly. He expects the same from us. He knew that he wouldn't get all kinds of accolades and recognition and, you know, people thinking he's all so wonderful. He knew what it was, how it was going to end. He knew he was going to get killed. He knew that this was going down a dark, dark road, but he was willing to do so. And so he came into this world gentle and lowly, and he says, I expect the same of you. He says, I promise you that it's not all for naught. You will inherit the earth, he says. And we bank on that promise, right? Because there's a lot of stuff out there I'd like to grab before it's too late. I know I only got maybe 80 years on this planet, and I'm already past halfway point. I'm not going to tell you all how old I am because, you know, you don't do that. Most of you know, kind of generally speaking, how old I am anyway. It doesn't matter. I'm going downhill. It's all downhill. I've never owned a home. Me and my wife had talked about this. We talked about this again just the other day. We talk about buying a house, and we don't. Why? Because God is first, and I don't think he's opened that door. Do I want one? It'd be kind of fun. I'd kind of like a house. We were just talking even about how sometimes we think we'd like more kids. But we have to be careful even with that, because God called us into the ministry first. I can't compromise the ministry by grabbing a hold of a whole bunch more stuff that I want to take along. I will eventually, if I'm not careful, compromise what God has called me to. And Jesus goes, it's okay. It's not yours now. I know you wish it was. And I know you're tempted to grab as much as you can right now. And by your own power, Justin, I know that you're sometimes tempted to take what's available even at the expense of my will, at the expense of being meek like I've instructed, even at the expense of being gentle, even at the expense of being godly. And I promise that one day you will have it all. So I don't know what that means. I don't know what it means, but I'm banking on the fact that he said I would one day inherit the earth. I'm thinking that I'm going to have a pretty decent piece of real estate one day. I've already decided that if I'm faithful with the one deal he's given me here, he's going to give me 10 cities. I already know what those cities are. They're just the small little podunk towns that I grew up near. You want the names? One of them is Pepin. One of them is Lund. I get Maiden Rock. I get Plum City. And I get Stockholm. You don't even know where those are. Maybe some of you, they're just little river towns along the Mississippi. I grew up there, and I'm like, it'd be so cool to be mayor here. Like, they don't even have people living there. Just a few abandoned houses. But it's still a township, and I want that. So I don't know. I just think that when Jesus says we're going to inherit the earth, it's going to surprise us when it happens. That's all. It's going to be above and beyond what we could ever have asked or thought or imagined or anything like that, because that's what he says. So the meek will inherit the earth. He goes on from there and says, blessed are those who hunger and thirst. Now, I'm not going to quite yet tell you what they hunger and thirst for. I'm just going to comment just briefly on how Americans approach hunger and thirst. Generally speaking, how American people approach hunger and thirst, they avoid it like the plague. God help me if my stomach ever rumbles. I need to be eating. I need to be drinking. Okay? The Bible says that many have turned their belly into a god. And Americans may be guilty of that here and there. What they're hungry for in this context is righteousness. So we're not talking about physical hunger here. We're not talking about physical thirst. We're talking about a spiritual craving for what's right. That's what righteousness means. It means this individual is hunger-panged, deeply desirous of what's right. And so they are going to do whatever they need to do to satisfy that hunger. That's what we do. Somebody who's hungry gets kind of crazy, hangry, in order to have their appetite fulfilled. They'll go to great lengths. So too, in the spiritual sense, I think that sometimes we have this spiritual hunger, a spiritual thirst that we discern within us, and we need it to be satisfied. But we have to be careful here, because if you're not, it could be lethal. It could be lethal if you're not careful about what you satisfy your spiritual cravings with. Listen to me carefully here. A lot of people have made the fatal mistake of trying to satisfy their spiritual hunger and thirst on religion. That's a bad idea. There is no sustenance in religion. You can have religion without God and Jesus at all. People are religious about recycling. People are religious about their cats. People are religious about the silliest of things. Here's one. Hockey. I know there's a lot of people in here that doesn't affect, but you all know what I mean. We live in a culture like Northland. We're all about hockey. I was at a hotel this weekend. I saw these kids come out of the hotel. They had a hockey tournament there, and we were blessed to share space with the riotous teens. At any rate, I saw this kid. He was about this tall, carrying a hockey bag that was about this tall. Just devotion. It's a religion. And I tell you, hockey won't satisfy your eternal soul, just so you know. Neither will cats. And what was the other one? Recycling. That won't do it. Okay? So, and there's a bunch of them. Here's another religion that will leave you sorely disappointed. Christianity. Just so you're aware of that. Okay? It is not religion that will satisfy your empty belly, spiritually speaking. It's a relationship with Jesus Christ and nothing short of that. So when people make the mistake of coming to church and building out this religious system that they are, and communion and the little wine or the grape juice, you know, depending, and I get baptized 18 times and I do all this religious stuff. How's that going for you? It's like eating styrofoam peanuts. Right? There's no sustenance in there. Did you know that you can starve to death glutting yourself on rabbit meat? Did you know that? There's something about rabbit meat doesn't have the certain enzymes or something in it to break down the proteins, and so you can just get fat on rabbit and die of starvation, malnutrition. It's like drinking salt water to quench your thirst. You know what that does, don't you? Do you? Why? Have you done it? Here, I need to explain this. Now, drinking salt water is only going to dehydrate you further. The more you drink, the more you think you've done well, when really the opposite is true. There's so many people that have kind of adopted this Christian religion. Congratulations, you've picked the right religion, but it's still religion. And it isn't saving your soul. And so we're on the hamster wheel of Christianity, thinking that we're doing the right thing, and you're just so close, right? I mean, it's like the carrot before the donkey. It's right there, but you're never going to get it. That's because it's religion. And so when you have this hunger and thirst in you, you've got to be careful of what you're satisfying your cravings on. You need Christ. Wasn't he the one that said, you know, unless you eat my flesh and drink my blood? Don't trip over that. It's weird, yes. But he's saying, I'm the one who nourishes you. You hungry? It's me you need. It's not my religion. You thirsty? Drink this. I'll give you rivers of living water. So be careful that you don't die with a full belly. The righteousness that's in view here, in verse 6, is a singular desire for a relationship of obedience and trust with God through Christ. A relationship of obedience and love with God through Christ. Relationship, relationship. That's the righteousness in view here. You just want to know Jesus. I don't want to tinker around with Christianity. I don't want to, you know, go through like trying to find God in nature. I want to know him. I don't want to know nature. I don't want Christianity. I don't want to know career. I want Jesus Christ. That's it. And I want to know him through my job. I want to experience him everywhere I go. I want to know what there is to know, and I don't want to sidestep any issues just because they're hard. I want to know Christ even where it's hard. I want to go into every classroom and learn everything I can. I don't want to just major in the fun stuff and minor in the hard stuff. I want a full education, Jesus. That's what I want. I want to know you. I want to know everything I can about you. I want to experience life with you. So how do you know then if people are hungry for truth or just feeding on religion? Okay, and I think this is something that we need to be careful of here and see if you don't fit the bill. How do you handle it when you're presented with a challenge? That will tell you everything about an individual. If you're feeding on religion and you're presented with a challenge, you'll probably abandon the difficulty in favor of some other religious offering that's easier for you. If you want what's right, and you hunger and thirst for what's right, you will bear through the difficulty because you know that there are important lessons Jesus is trying to teach you even through hardship. And you will count yourself blessed. You will be happy in the enduring. You know what's funny about this? I want you to notice, all the way back at the beginning of the chapter, it says in, actually the last verse of chapter 4, in verse 25, it says that great multitudes follow Jesus from all over the place. And then in the first verse of chapter 5, it says Jesus goes up on a mountain, right? And then it says at the end of verse 1 that only his disciples came to him. Only those who were hungry for the truth that Jesus was about to dispel. Only those who were hungry for righteousness and thirsty for what was right were willing to make the climb up that mountain. Only his disciples. In fact, we don't see the multitudes again until after Jesus is done preaching this three-chapter sermon. We don't see the multitudes again until chapter 8, verse 1. As soon as they come back down the mountain, there's the disciples again. There's the multitudes again. They're just taking it easy. Jesus doesn't make it easy for you. That's the bottom line. You will know how hungry you are because Jesus won't make it easy for them. You, if anything, he makes it more difficult. It's his way of feeding you. Proverbs 16:26 says, it's good for workers to have an appetite because an empty stomach is what drives them on. Those who are hungry prove their hunger by following Christ anywhere, everywhere. Just like those who are seriously hungry in the physical realm will eat just about anything. You know, my mom always told me, you know, I was one of those picky kids that would just eat the fun stuff and then leave the spinach or whatever it was. She always told me, maybe your mom told you the same thing, if you're hungry, you'll eat it. She always told me, I didn't like it because it was so true. I wasn't not eating it because I was full. I was not eating it because it was gross. And sometimes the places Jesus wants to take us appear on the surface to be rather gross. I don't want to go there. That's unappealing. I don't want to do that. And Jesus goes, if you're hungry, you will. And if you will, you're blessed. Because your hunger drives you on. Your empty stomach drives you on. Blessed are those who hunger for righteousness, for they shall be filled, he says, even if it requires climbing a mountain. In verse 7, blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. This idea of mercy is a simple concern for other people. And Jesus says, you're a happy person that's concerned with other people. You know who the most unhappy people are on this planet? Those who are concerned for nobody other than themselves. Can't remember who it was, but somebody once said, the smallest package on earth is a man or a woman totally wrapped up in themselves. And Jesus goes, if you're totally wrapped up in the concerns of others and you have that gift of mercy, if you're concerned how other people are doing and you put your attention on others, he says, even as much as you do for yourself, if you loved others as much as you loved yourself, he goes, you're blessed. That's a happy life. That's a happy life. You know, you notice ever when you do a nice thing for somebody that God has built this deal into you that gives you a warm feeling? You ever notice that? Like how it makes you feel good to help somebody? You notice that, don't you? You help somebody, you're there to meet a need, and you go away feeling just awful. Why? I never do that again. No, you go away like, that was cool, and I was so glad to help, and so were they. And mercy here is pictured by Jesus as reciprocal. Do you know what I mean by that? He's saying, if you show it to others, it'll be shown to you. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. So it's reciprocal. There's another place in the Bible. Jesus says, do unto others as you would have done unto you. That's called the golden rule. It's a big deal. I think there's even other world religions that have adopted that golden rule to some extent. But at any rate, it's reciprocal. And it's that way oftentimes by God's design, that the way that God has told us we should expect to be treated by him is the way that others should expect to be treated by us. In other words, God is going to deal with me the way that I deal with others in a lot of different categories. Mercy here seems to be one of them. In Psalm chapter 18, it says, to the faithful, God shows himself faithful. To those with integrity, God shows himself as one with integrity, right? It's reciprocal. To the pure, God shows himself pure. And the verse ends with this, but to the crooked, God shows himself shrewd. So it's all about how you approach the people around you that colors how you perceive God to be approaching you, treating you, dealing with you. So if God seems to be particularly harsh, particularly, right, kind of shrewd or crooked, you got to ask yourself, well, how are you treating other people? Listen, you'll be happy if you're merciful toward other people because then you'll be shown mercy. And the same could be said of a few other of these attributes. Blessed are you when you're faithful because God will be faithful. And blessed are those who have integrity. Blessed are those who are pure, which is in fact the very next one he gets to, purity in heart. He says, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. This purity of heart, you know what purity means? It means all the imperfections are gone. Like you can purify gold by passing it through intense heat, and then the gold melts, and the dross comes to the top, and you can skim off the dross. That's how they purify gold or silver. You can purify water if you got a water purifier on your sink, under your sink, you know, or a thing in your fridge, whatever the case. You're taking out the impurities. Generally speaking, when you take impurities out of anything, it makes that thing better. It makes that thing more valuable. Jesus says a similar thing is true with your heart. If you have the impurities removed, if you do your part and God cooperates to remove the imperfections and the sins and the dark thoughts and all the rest, you'll be happy. You'll be happy. How could it not be true that somebody wouldn't be happy if they had a pure heart? Honestly, you know what really bothers me? It's I don't know if it's tops, but it's up there, is when I see what's in my heart. That ain't happy. My heart's not a happy place, you know? But when Jesus is my greatest preoccupation, and he's the center of my thoughts, and I get a glimpse of a pure heart, that's a good day. I have a happy day. I'm blessed. And he says, blessed are those who are pure in heart. This means having unmixed motives. You know, a lot of Christians, we do stuff in the Christian realm for different reasons. We're talking about motives here. Why do we do what we do? A pure heart is a single-hearted, undiluted devotion to God, a commitment to doing God's will through Christ. It means that the whole person is given over to God. That sounds good. Sounds happy to me. Kent Hughes, commenting on this passage, says, singleness of heart is one of the biggest challenges to 20th century Christians. I would say 21st century Christians, just to update the passage. He says, very few in this frenetic age are capable of the spiritual attention that this beatitude calls for. Few. Few in this age and in our culture are capable of the attention and commitment and devotion and cooperation with God that this beatitude calls for. In other words, very few will ever be blessed for having a pure heart because they have mixed motives, because they have dark thoughts, because they have sin issues. But Jesus says, for those who strive to remove the impurities from within, I promise, he says, they shall see God. They will see God. Hebrews 12:14 says, without holiness, no one will see God. So again, this happiness is hand in hand with holiness. Without holiness, you won't see God. Without seeing God, you're not a happy person. 1 John 3:2 says, we are already God's children, but he has not yet shown us what we will be like when Christ appears. But we do know that we will be like him, for we will see him as he really is. And get this, John follows up by saying, all who have this hope in themselves will purify their heart, just as Christ is pure. Okay? Now, let me say something. If you're inspired to get to cleaning up your heart, you're like, okay, I'm going to set my goal is to have a pure heart, and I'm going to start doing that. Well, you need to know something here, that you can't purify your heart by cleaning up your speech. Well, I'm going to quit swearing so much. Great. That would be a good start, but that won't guarantee a pure heart. You cannot purify the heart by cleaning up your behavior. Okay? Now you're nothing more than a moralist. Still no closer to Christ for all of your outward cleanliness. Jesus condemned the Pharisees for being clean on the outside. He's like, you guys look stellar. You look stellar, but dang, I can see the inside and it's awful. So he's not interested in us cleaning up the outside, the speech, the behavior, and all those things. The order actually has to be reversed. The inside must be purified. And if it is, the speech, the behavior, all the outwards will begin to follow suit. They will conform to what's going on the inside. You have to insist on that. Don't let yourself buy into a program that reverses the order. A religious system where you can just jump through hoops and look good to everybody. No. Insist that what's on the inside is dealt with first. Deal with heart issues first. If you recognize that you have them, go to God in prayer and beg him to help you with these heart issues. He will set things in motion that if you're careful to follow his instructions and you will go along with his program, he will answer your prayer. Be careful that you don't buck him once he sets them in motion, because that's the hard part. Praying, God, help my hard heart, help my impure heart, help my dark thoughts. That's the easy part, praying for it. But when he starts to actually initiate the process of purification, right, the part where the gold actually goes through the intense heat, that's where you're going to scream and jump out of the crucible. I don't want this. I take that prayer back. If you want a pure heart, begin by asking God to purify your heart. The outward will take care of itself. Verse 9, blessed are the peacemakers. I have something to say about this. Blessed are the peacemakers. They will be called sons of God. I have to wonder before I even get into any explanation what you have in your mind as far as what it means to be a peacemaker. If you were to profile a peacemaker, what kind of person would they be? I want you to think of that just for a moment. And then I want you to understand that in a fallen world like ours, peace comes at a cost. A high cost. Oftentimes, peace includes the spilling of blood. Making peace sometimes includes the loss of life. And so Jesus says, blessed are those not who ignorantly think that peace will happen on its own, or those who passively maintain a peace that's already there. No. Jesus says, blessed are those who are willing to actively engage in the fight that's necessary to establish peace in places where it isn't. Blessed are people who are willing to go to war in order to obtain peace. Jesus is saying, blessed are those who are engaged in full combat Christianity. Are you engaged in full combat Christianity? Then you're not happy. Unless you know what it means to go into unpeaceful places, places of unrest, spiritual displacement, violence, and bring peace by doing whatever is necessary to establish God's righteousness. For some of you, it's your family, and you need to start there. You don't even need to leave your own house. Others, it's in your job, and you need to bring peace into that environment. These are peacemakers, not peacekeepers. There's a difference. Peacemakers. Peacemaking isn't peaceful at all. It means going into spaces where peace doesn't exist so that you can bring it about. A peacemaker doesn't hide from conflict. A peacemaker goes into conflict. The Bible tells us that Jesus is the Prince of Peace. Did you know that that's one of his nicknames? He's got a ton of nicknames. Dude and bro aren't one of them, but he's got a bunch of other ones. Prince of Peace is one. Do you know how he makes peace? Colossians 1:20 says that Jesus made peace by shedding his blood on the cross. There has never been such an example historically of violence and abuse to the undeserved than there was on Golgotha, on Calvary's cross. So now, let me clarify here before we go any further. Who is it that these peacemakers, if you want to be a peacemaker this morning, good, join the ranks. Okay, if you want to be a peacemaker this morning, who do you need to go, what is it, where's the war? Because I don't want you to get distracted on skirmishes, peripheral skirmishes. I want you to know where the war is so that you can really do the fighting. What unpeaceful, godless environments do we go into in order to establish peace? Who do we fight against? Where's the war? Is it the Democrats? I'm speaking to the right-wingers. Do we fight against all things blue? Is it the liberals, Christian? Is that where we fight war? Is it the abortion doctors? Do we gotta go get them? Is that it? Is it the owners of all the head shops and all the bars and all the brothels that are out there in this good old-fashioned American country? No. No. Because the Bible says explicitly that we don't war against flesh and blood. We don't wrestle against people. That's not the problem. The problem is principalities and powers. It's evil that's in the air, brought about by real demonic entities that have influenced all our culture. Colossians 2:15 says that Jesus disarmed these principalities and powers through his own crucifixion. So, where is the war then? Where's the real war? I know that we fight against principalities and powers, but then again, Jesus disarmed those principalities and powers. So where is our first line of contact when it comes to spiritual combat and conflict? Where is our war? Yours. You. That's the answer. The war is against you, first and foremost. The part of you, Christian, that's still allied with the devil. I know you're born again and everybody here is a Christian and that's wonderful. The spirit in you is allied with Jesus Christ. But do you know who your flesh is allied with? Oh, I hate to say it. I'm not even going to say it. I think you know who I'm talking about. Your flesh wants to do what's wrong. It's allied, not with God. Paul says, "In my flesh is no good thing." He says in another place, it craves what is opposite of what the Spirit desires. So I'll tell you who your flesh is allied with, and it's not God. So when you go to war, I want you to know where the real enemy lies so that you can attack it with all the viciousness that's becoming of a soldier at war, and that's your flesh. So, peacemakers. You can either make peace or you can disturb the peace, your call. Jesus says, blessed are those who make it. Jeremiah says, cursed are those who won't. We went through this last Wednesday. Jeremiah 40:8-10 says, "Cursed are those who hold back their swords from shedding blood. Cursed are those who don't go to war." And Jesus says, "Blessed are those who do." Verse 10, "Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." I already mentioned this earlier, but happiness, the kind that Jesus is describing, won't be found by avoiding difficult situations. Please note that. Happiness won't be found by successfully bypassing every difficulty in life. Okay? In fact, Jesus is offering our greatest chance at happiness in the midst of the most undesirable circumstances imaginable. He uses the term persecution to describe them. There couldn't be anything worse than this. The worst persecution, the term means hunted. And Jesus goes, that's where happiness is. Not by avoiding difficulty, but by following Jesus through it. This being hunted, this persecution that he describes as a blessed place, an envious life, he says, this is a kind of a life that includes anything from mockery and ridicule for your faith, all the way up to torture and execution, which has been faced by countless Christians over the duration of the church age. A righteous life, one that's entirely centered on God and his will, is going to be conspicuous. People are going to notice it out there, and it's going to attract persecution sooner or later. It will. But Jesus says, you're blessed. You're happy. You should be congratulated. I just think about that passage in Acts chapter 5, last part of the chapter, in verse 40, 41. Peter and the apostles are out, and they're preaching the gospel, and they get themselves in hot water, and they get physically assaulted for it. And in verse 41, it says that they left that place basically jumping for joy, leaping for joy. They're just overjoyed at having been counted worthy to suffer for Christ's sake. I wonder if you got the snot pounded out of you physically so that you came to church next week with black eyes and broken teeth because you had, in a righteous way, shared Christ with somebody who didn't take it well. I wonder how many people in this church would envy you. I am telling you the truth when I say I would be one. Deep in the soul of a genuine Christian is a desire to suffer with Christ. The Apostle Paul did. He wasn't unfamiliar with this particular blessing. In Philippians 3:10, Paul says, I want to know Christ and experience the mighty power that raised him from the dead. I want to suffer with him. Jesus says, blessed are you when they revile and persecute you and say all kinds of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice and be exceedingly glad. You know why? Because your reward in heaven will be awesome. There is a greatness of reward that's reserved particularly for those who endure this kind of persecution, this mockery, this reviling. Jesus goes, it's going to be great. Because that's how they persecuted the prophets who were before you. This is traditional. This is classic stuff, guys. And Paul goes, I know that and I want that. He says it in Philippians. Earlier in that same letter, he calls that kind of suffering a privilege. He says, don't be intimidated in any way by your enemies. This is for you guys. This will be a sign to them that they are going to be destroyed, but that you are going to be saved, even by God himself. For you've been given not only the privilege of trusting in Christ, but also the privilege of suffering for him. We are in this struggle together, he says. And I think that's a word for this generation, even though the Apostle Paul is long gone, having, like they say, according to church history, been decapitated for his faith. His voice still speaks loud and clear to 2022, saying to you and me both, we're in this together. Get your head cut off too. It'd be awesome. I don't know if we believe that or not, but Jesus says, no, it's true. You're blessed. In some Bible notes that I read along the way, it says that this blessing is made known as the believer, shares the same kind of suffering Jesus faced, the sufferings that attend faithful witness in a fallen world. If you are a faithful witness in a fallen world, you can expect certain levels of persecution and certain amounts of it as you go along. And Jesus, always remember, Jesus says, you're blessed. Now, listen, in conclusion, there's been countless books written on the key to finding happiness. I think they're all awful. Because none of them read like this, you know? I mean, you're looking at the preface and it's like, you know, brace yourself, and you get to chapter one, and it's like, happy are those who are sad. Yeah, I think that's pretty exclusive to Matthew chapter 5. The things that Jesus says on the Sermon on the Mount. John MacArthur, a lot of you are familiar with his teachings. He says this, the blessings of the Beatitudes are for those who are realistic about their sinfulness, who are repentant of their sins, and who are responsive to God and his righteousness. Those who are unblessed in this life, those people who aren't happy, those who are shut out of the kingdom are proud. They're the arrogant. They're the unrepentant. They are the self-sufficient and the self-righteous, who see in themselves no unworthiness and feel no need for God's help and no need for God's righteousness. They're the cursed. They're the unhappy. And guys, we are surrounded by them. In and out of the church, and I'm sorry to say it. Not many people that I know who are following Christ's principles and believing what he says in these first 12 verses. When you mourn over sin in yourself and sin in the world, do you feel Christ's comfort? Do you have a craving for what's right? Do you hunger and thirst for it with all you've got? And is God filling your mouth with good things? Are you being persecuted? Are you a faithful witness out there in a Christ-rejecting world, and are you catching heat for it? And if so, how does that make you feel? Just the very prospect that it could happen tomorrow morning, how does that make you feel? Are these things that you long for, or are these things that you avoid? That's the big question. It's all contingent upon which kingdom you're living in. Jesus says, my citizens are happy when these things happen. The world hates it. Let's pray. We come before you, Lord, this morning, admitting that our thinking on some of these issues has probably been so conditioned by the world and our culture, by our own flesh and what we want to believe, and in some cases, even by what the church is teaching. This is not a positive message. For you to come along and say these things would have been mind-blowing, earth-shattering to the people who first heard them. Our ears have probably grown a little dull to what they say because we've, for the most part, read these verses before, but I pray that you would renew them for us. Help us to re-engage what you're saying to us through them, that we might be happy. I don't want to be a hamster on a wheel, and I don't want us to be just running along like rats in a race. I want to be happy. And Blaise Pascal wants us to be happy, and Thomas Jefferson wants us to be happy, and God and Jesus together want us to be happy. And so we're all in this together. We all agree. We just want to be happy.